It is my absolute honor to introduce to you guys Peter Schweitzer. Peter Schweitzer is the president of Government Accountability Institute, a best-selling author, and a member of Young America's Foundation's board of directors. He is a partner in the Washington, D.C. firm Oval Office Writers, which provides speechwriting and communication services for corporate executives and political figures. From 2008 to 2009, he was a consultant to the Office of Presidential Speechwriting in the White House. His books have been translated into 11 languages and include several New York Times or Washington Post bestsellers. Peter is author of the book Extortion: How Politicians Extract Your Money, Buy Votes, and Line Their Own Pockets. Both Extortion and his previous book, Throw Them All Out, were New York Times bestsellers and were featured on CBS's 60 Minutes. Other nonfiction works include Architects of Ruin, Victory, Do As I Say, Not As I Do, and Makers and Takers. Additionally, my favorite is Clinton Cash, the untold story of how and why foreign governments and businesses helped make Bill and Hillary rich. His academic books include landmark speeches of the American conservative movement, the Reagan presidency, Assessing the Man and His Legacy, and The Fall of the Wall, reassessing the causes and consequences of the end of the Cold War. His articles have included appearances in Foreign Affairs, The New York Times, The Wall Street Journal, The Washington Post, LA Times, National Review, and elsewhere. He has appeared on numerous radio and television programs as well. Peter received his Master of Philosophy from Oxford University and his Bachelor's of Arts from George Washington University. He currently lives with his wife in Florida and their children. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming Peter Schweitzer.
Thank you. It's great to be here, the merging of young and older. We've got a lot of YAF alumni here. I was a YAF alumni, and one of my favorite things in my biography, in my history, was the fact that I was a campus activist. It also happens that my favorite story about Ronald Reagan involved campus activism. You see, before he was president of the United States, Ronald Reagan was governor of California. And as governor of California, he was on the Board of Regents of the University of California. And in 1967, he showed up at Berkeley for a meeting of the Board of Regents. And with him was his longtime aide, Lynn Nofziger, who later went with him to the White House. And as they met inside and talked about various issues, word got on the street among what you would call back then the hippie crowd that Reagan was in the building. And not liking his politics, they decided to sort of confront him. So they built a group around the building where he was meeting, and they started chanting, "Make love, not war. Make love, not war." And the crescendo got louder and louder and louder. And Reagan said to Lynn Nofziger when the meeting was done, "Well, it's time to go." Lynn Nofziger said, "Well, there's a crowd outside and I'm a little bit concerned about them." And they kept chanting, "Make love, not war. Make love, not war." And Reagan said, "Well, I'm not going to be intimidated. We're just going to go out, get in the car, and go back to the governor's mansion." And they continued to chant, "Make love, not war. Make love, not war." And when they got out to the crowd, Lynn Nofziger looked very nervous, and Reagan turned to him and said, "Lynn, don't worry about it. They don't look like they're capable of doing either one." Now, I'd like to talk to you today about a couple of things. One is looking at the left, the modern day left. I don't need to tell a lot of you on college campuses about how the left operates, but I want to give you three, I think, central tenets of how the left operates today and how it can be counteracted. And then I want to talk about the future of the conservative movement and where we are going. Now, dissecting the left is something that a lot of people do in a lot of different ways. What I've tried to do is distill three basic points that I think are key to understanding the modern left and also understanding their vulnerabilities. The first thing I think you need to understand about the left today is that they are intellectually dishonest. They are profoundly intellectually dishonest. Now, what do I mean by that? Well, if you ever debate somebody from the left, a self-professed socialist, you will find that they will never defend anything in the real world. And this has a long pedigree on the left. It used to be in the 1930s that the left embraced the Soviet Union. But then Stalin came around, and a lot of people on the left said, well, that didn't work out so well. So then they moved to embracing China. When Chairman Mao and his revolution led to the mass murder of tens of millions of people, they abandoned their love of China, and the left then embraced Fidel Castro in Cuba. Some of them still embrace Castro today, but many of them won't even defend Fidel Castro anymore because of their human rights violations. From Cuba, they moved on to Nicaragua in the 1980s. You won't find many of them that will defend Daniel Ortega or Nicaragua anymore. And then they finally moved in the 2000s to embracing the grand experiment in Venezuela. And now you will find that a lot of people on the left won't even defend the regime of Venezuela anymore. And the explanation that you will often get from people on the left is, I'm a socialist, but I don't believe in those countries and what they're doing because it's not, quote unquote, real socialism. Have you heard that explanation? In other words, you bring up human rights violations in Venezuela, you bring about discussions about other problems with socialist regimes, and they will say, well, that's not the socialism that I believe in. So what they are essentially doing is creating an abstract and not having to defend anything in the real world. Meanwhile, what do? They critique and they attack a real-world system of free market economics and the American experience that has for now several centuries generated prosperity, has generated increasing amounts of freedom for a larger number of people. The point being, the American experiment is real. The American experiment is successful. And what they do, thank you. What they do is they critique a real-world system that works, that helps people, and that improves lives, and what they want to do is simply defend an abstract. Well, my view is don't let them get away with it. The next time somebody critiques American free market capitalism, because no system is perfect, but the next time somebody critiques the American capitalist system, and you critique Venezuela, and they say, well, that's not real socialism, just tell them, well, America's not real free market economics. You know, the point is, it's impossible to have a conversation with somebody on the left if they're not prepared to look at and examine and accept the real world problems that real world socialist regimes have. So the first thing I would tell you is be sure to keep them intellectually honest and don't let them get away with defending a unicorn and saying that what they want is a unicorn when you're dealing with a real world system like free world economics. The second thing I wanted to mention, and that is this fundamental thing you have to recognize is that socialism is a very, very old idea. Now, this is not what you're going to hear from your college professors and from socialists on campus. They're going to tell you they have the modern idea. They have the scientific idea. They have the new idea. They have the wave of the future. But the reality is actually the opposite. And I would commend to all of you a terrific book that came out in 1980 called The Socialist Phenomenon by Igor Stravaykin. He is a Russian writer. And what he points out in the socialist phenomenon in brilliant form is the fact that socialism is actually one of the oldest, if not the oldest, economic idea in human history. And what he does is he charts through the ancient civilizations of Egypt and Aztecs and the Byzantine Empire and the Mayans. And what he demonstrates is that they were all state-run, centralized economic systems. And in fact, they had quote unquote, egalitarian principles when it came to economics. And in many cases in these civilizations, you weren't allowed to have private property. It was what is modern day socialism. So don't let them say that they have the new fresh idea that's the wave of the future. They are peddling one of the oldest, if not the oldest, economic idea that is known to man. Now in contrast, freedom and individualism, that in the span of human history is the new idea. That is the unique idea. And if you chart it, thank you. And if you chart it, it began with an idea that is central to Western civilization, and that is the idea of individualism. It started with the Judeo-Christian idea that individuals could communicate directly with their God. They didn't need a mediator. They didn't need to, as the Mayans did, need to have a facilitator or commit some kind of human sacrifice. That you as an individual could communicate and have a relationship with your God. That was a central idea of Western civilization. And that central idea came to develop the notion of individual human rights. The idea that you can own property, the idea that you have certain things that you can be protected from, arbitrary power by the government, etc. This is the unique, new, fresh idea in human history. And you all need to recognize that you are the torchbearers of a new idea, of the new wave of the future built on this foundation from the past, and that the ideas that they're peddling of a centralized government, of a state-run enterprise, those are the old ideas, and they belong where? On the ash heap of history. So what I would encourage you again, as you're discussing these issues on campus with your professors, talk to them about the fact that socialism is an old idea, it's not a new idea, and it has consistently failed everywhere that it's been tried. Well, the third and final thing I want to talk about as it relates to the left, and I probably don't have to tell a lot of people that are on campus about this, and that is just the profound arrogance of the left. The profound arrogance of the left. And let me just illustrate that with one example, and then we can talk more about it. Now, the left believes that they can essentially take a very complex system, and they are smart enough to account for human frailties, human decision-making, the economics that underline that system, that they can themselves change that system and make it better. And let me give you a very specific example, and that would be Senator Bernie Sanders of Vermont. Now, anybody here that has done a history of looking at Bernie Sanders and his background would be quite shocked, maybe not, to discover that Bernie Sanders was 39 years old when he got his first full-time consistent job. 39 years old. 39 years old. Before that, he just sort of bumped along doing various things. In fact, there's a story by actually one of his friends when he was in Burlington that accounts when he was in his mid-30s, he had his power cut out because he wasn't paying his utility bill. And what Bernie did was he ran an extension cord down and plugged into a little old lady's apartment that lived below him and basically sapped power from her. So Bernie Sanders did not have a consistent job until he was 39 years old. When he ran for the U.S. Senate in the 1970s, Bernie Sanders was on unemployment insurance. He was on unemployment insurance. The other thing you need to know about Bernie Sanders is when he ran for Congress in 1992, he was actually charged with a form of tax evasion and had to pay a penalty because he was not paying the federal employment taxes on his campaign workers. He was listing them as all his consultants as a means to avoid paying federal income taxes for his own employees. And of course, anybody who's paying attention to the modern situation now with his campaign knows that his workers on his campaign are asking for $15 an hour as a minimum wage, something that he has advocated for everybody else, but Bernie Sanders has said, "I'm sorry, I can't afford to pay you that." Now, why do I bring this all up? I bring this all up because Bernie Sanders, with that background, that history, that lack of experience, says, trust me, with 20% of the entire U.S. gross national product, which is the healthcare industry, and I'm going to fix it. Now, is that not the definition of hubris and arrogance for somebody with that lack of experience and expertise to think that he is going to fix 20% of the U.S. economy? Sanders, to me, personifies the problem with the modern-day left today, and that is their arrogance, their sense and their belief that they can fix very complex things, and when they destroy them and they damage them, they walk on and they just move to the left next institution that they claim they're going to fix. So this is the arrogance of the left, and I think you need to call them out on it. So how do you call them out on it? I think you explain to them the fact that they are being arrogant and they are assuming qualities and beliefs that they really don't have any right to be carrying forth. And they need to be confronted with that. Finally, let me just talk a little bit about what the future holds, what I think the future holds. Now, the future, and I'm speaking here primarily to the student activists here, the future largely is up to you. There are people in this audience, myself, Frank Donatelli, Ron Pearson, others, who have fought the fight for decades, and we're going to continue to fight the fight. But the future really rests on you. And what I would ask you to do is to go back and study the American Revolution. Most historians say that during the American Revolution, the colonies were basically divided into three groups. One third were the patriots who wanted independence from England. One third were basically neutral. And one third wanted to stay with the crown. So the revolutionaries that won the American Revolution, that led to American independence, were never really a majority of the population until the end, when it came to sending representatives to vote on a new constitution. So I bring that up to you for this reason. When you're on campus, sometimes you're going to feel isolated. You're going to feel like you're not in the majority. You're going to feel like the numbers are against you. Don't let that discourage you. Focus on the fact that you have great ideas. One of my other great stories about Ronald Reagan was he was once asked after he left the White House, somebody said, you know, you're just a great man. I mean, look at all that you accomplished. What do you feel about the legacy that you've created? And Ronald Reagan, in typical fashion, in contrast to the arrogance of the left, said, I'm not a great man. I just believe in great ideas. And that's what I say to all of you. And that's why I say to all of you, you believe in great ideas. You believe in the ideas that for centuries have created prosperity, individualism, and freedom, and will continue to do so if you have the courage to carry that torch to the next generation. Now, I don't have to tell all of you on campus the challenges that you face. You face censorship, right? You face harassment. You face name-calling. People here have probably been called racists, Nazis, greedy, all kinds of things. These are the common tactics on the left. But I'm going to ask you to think about these things for a second. When somebody tries to censor somebody and to prevent them from talking, when somebody resorts to name-calling, juvenile name-calling, instead of having an argument, when people do those things, is that a sign of strength? Is that a sign of strength? No, I don't think so. I think it's a sign of profound weakness. Look, if the left believed that your ideas were totally kooky and totally unattractive and were not of interest to anybody, the first thing they would do on campus is give you a microphone and say, go at it. Talk all you want. They know the power of the ideas that you espouse, and they know the attractiveness of those ideas. That's the reason they have to censor you. The reason they have to call you names, well, you know, go back to middle school. We all spend time in middle school, right? If you were having an argument with a sibling or with a friend, and they started resorting to name-calling, was that usually because they were winning the argument? No. It was because they were losing the argument. So my plea to you is to realize that, yes, you are outnumbered. Yes, they are using these very, very difficult and aggressive tactics. But you are on the winning side, or we are on the winning side, if you have the courage to keep doing what you're doing. So let me just say in closing, you need to be an optimist, but more than that, you need to be a realist. One of my favorite stories involves an admiral who was Admiral Stockdale, who was a POW in Vietnam, and he stayed in the famous Hanoi Hilton. You've all heard of the Hanoi Hilton, where they kept American POWs. Admiral Stockdale was the senior POW there, and for that reason, he got a lot of brutal treatment by his captors. When I was out at the Hoover Institution, Admiral Stockdale was a fellow there as well, and I asked him, I said, what was your experience? You had all these POWs that were there. What was your experience about who made it and who didn't make it, because he was there for 7 years, I think, in those brutal conditions. And he said, well, you know, it's real simple. The first ones to die were the optimists. And I said, what? The first ones to die were the optimists? He says, yeah. The first ones to die were the optimists because the optimists believed that their release was around the corner. So when Easter would come by, they'd say, well, we're going to get released. The Vietnamese are going to release us at Easter as a goodwill gesture. Easter came and went. Then they said, you know, look, Thanksgiving and Christmas are coming. They're going to release us as a goodwill gesture, and then we're going to be able to go home. And Thanksgiving and Christmas came and went, and they were never released. And he said, the optimists died of broken hearts because they were expecting to be released soon, and it didn't happen. He said, the second ones who didn't make it were the pessimists, because the pessimists said, we're never going to get out of here. All is lost. What is the point? They were the second ones who passed away. The survivors were the realists. The realists. And the realists were the ones who said, you know what? We don't know if we're going to get out of here. These guys may never release us. We could be released tomorrow. We just don't know. But my job is to survive the next day, the next week, and the next month. That's what the realists did, and that's why the realists survive. So when you're on campus, be courageous, be confident, and also be realists. Thank you very much. Thank you. Now, my favorite part of YAF events are the Q&A sessions. So we always get great questions. So we've got microphones. We're going to start over there. Yes, please. Why don't you tell us your name and which school you're from?
Hi, my name is... Oh, that was loud. My name is Jessica. I live in Bellingham, Washington. It's 2 hours north of Seattle.
Excellent.
I'm a biology major, and I feel censored because I feel skeptical about the topic that we really haven't touched on, which is climate change.
Yep.
I was wondering your insights on maybe that as a tactic in, so, you know, just could you give me your thoughts on it?
Sure. Well, look, I think that there's been a lot of alarmism about climate change. You can go back and look at a UN report that was done in 1989 that said basically you have 10 years. There have been other reports, et cetera. The science is debated. What I would say is when you look at what political figures are doing, don't look at what they're saying. Look at what they're actually doing. And let me give you a couple of real-world examples of that. As I mentioned in the introduction, I'm the head of something called the Government Accountability Institute. We do research, and we're doing a very interesting project we're going to release in the fall. Mm-hmm. And here's what we did. We looked at the major cities in the United States, San Francisco, New York, Boston, Miami, who are subject to this threat of sea level rise. And the mayors and the governors of these states and of these cities have been very alarmist. You know, there have been predictions that a third of Manhattan is going to be underwater in 25 years. Here's the problem. What is the city of New York doing? Now, they've created a map that shows you the third of Manhattan that's going to be underwater. But when you look at the New York City Planning Office, they are right now approving building permits to build large skyscrapers on areas that are supposed to be underwater in 20 years. These cities, which are talking about the fact that they are going to be, you know, engulfed with water in 20 years, are writing 20-year bonds for capital projects in their cities. And in their bond issuances to investors, they never mention climate change as a risk. So my question is, if de Blasio or Gavin Newsom or other people are so alarmed and so confident that this thing is going to be chaotic, then why are they not actually taking actions? I mean, if you really believe that a third of Manhattan is going to be underwater, why are you issuing building permits that you say are going to be underwater in 20 years? It makes no sense. So what I would always say, a good rule of politics on anything, is don't listen to what people say. Look at what they do.
Thank you very much.
You're welcome. Yes, over here.
I just wanted to ask you about the spending caps that the Senate voted on Friday. My question was, why does the free market require trillions of dollars in spending on non-military in the fiscal year 2019, 2020, and 2021, if that's not the Senate's focus? Why does that matter?
Yeah, no, look, I think that the national debt and the deficit is a massive problem, and it's basically a bipartisan problem. Now, there are Republicans that are trying to cut back on spending, but they're a minority. And the challenge, the problem politically, is there's not a lot of political benefit to a politician stopping spending projects. Voters tell them that that's what they want, and some voters do want that. But the problem is they expend a lot of capital to achieve that, and they don't get a lot of payoff. And the problem is that political figures in Washington, D.C., are ultimately thinking primarily about their electoral prospects, especially in the House where you're up every 2 years. So I agree with you, it's a huge problem. And I think one of the lost opportunities that the Trump administration has had, as the Obama administration had, as the Bush administration had, was to actually tackle spending. And I am a firm believer that the people that are gonna suffer the most as a result of this are your generation. Because I do not believe that deficit spending is sustainable. You get economists that tell you, oh yeah, no, it doesn't really apply, debts don't really apply. There's no example in history, even of governments, being able to sustain debt over profoundly long periods of time and there not be serious consequences for it. So I agree with you. I think it's a travesty. And I think there's an example where, you know, there are individuals from both political parties for different reasons. Maybe one wants spending increases of 7%, the other 5%, but they're both culpable and they both, I think, are responsible for the fiscal state that we're in today.
But Republicans say they wouldn't want to reduce spending on military, and they won't reduce spending on military, and then they won't get Democrats to reduce spending on domestic issues.
Right.
So how do you reconcile those?
I am probably the biggest military hawk in the sense of a strong military. My mentor when I was younger was Caspar Weinberger, who was Reagan's Secretary of Defense. But to me, there is no way you are going to get cuts in spending without having cuts in military spending along with domestic spending. So if you believe the debt is a problem, you're going to have cuts to both. And anybody who tells you you keep increasing the military budget and cut domestic spending is I think, selling you swampland in Florida.
I agree.
Thank you. Over here. Yes.
Hi, my name's Nicole Evangelista. I'm from the University of Denver. And my question is, during your speech, you mentioned intellectual dishonesty. And so how do we maintain intellectual honesty with the left when usually when we give them facts, the left usually ignores them or dismisses them? And so overall, how do we regain or maintain intellectual honesty?
Well, I think by presenting facts and having an argument and a coherent and consistent argument, I think you are being intellectually dishonest. I think ultimately, you know, think about it this way. It's a little bit like you have a romantic relationship with somebody, right? You know, ultimately, you alone can't make the relationship work. If you're dating somebody and he's a jerk, he doesn't show up on time, he doesn't text or call you back, you can try various things, but it's just not going to work. It's the same thing, I think, when you're trying to engage and have a serious conversation with somebody. Sometimes you just need to sort of, you know, wipe your boots clean and move on because they're not interested. But sometimes what you can do is when they start going the name-calling direction or they start, you know, engaging in this, well, I believe in real socialism, that's not real socialism. You need to call them out on it and say, look, you're asking me to defend a real complex system that has 300 million people living in it, and you're pointing out flaws, and yeah, there are flaws in our system, but you're not prepared to defend anything. So, you know, why have a conversation? That's like saying, you know, I'm going to compare, the Toyota Corolla that I own with a Ferrari that you wish you owned. What's the point of that? There's no point in having a conversation like that. So that's what I would do. But I would say ultimately, you're not going to be able to argue somebody into understanding what you're saying if they don't want to go there.
Thank you.
You're welcome. Yes, over there.
So government accountability is clearly something that's really important to you. I've watched a lot of congressional hearings of like especially with Trey Gowdy and Jason Chaffetz, who are two of my heroes.
Yep.
But and Jason Chaffetz is from my home state of Utah, but he unexpectedly resigned. He was chair of the oversight committee.
Yep.
And that was pretty hard for me. I mean, again, he's one of my heroes. And then Trey Gowdy took his place, and then he resigned.
Right.
And when you watch the hearings, I mean, I'm sure you know that they always say, oh, I can't give you that information because someone from the Justice Department told me I can't tell you that. And they're just so frustrated because everyone knows that they're guilty. Do you know, I don't know. It just feels like sometimes there's no hope for government accountability.
I understand. Look, we deal with this on a regular basis, and it's easy to get frustrated, but you have to give Jason Chaffetz and Trey Gowdy a lot of credit. I think they both did terrific jobs. I think they both handled themselves very, very well. It's a necessary job, and it's a dirty job. And I think sometimes, you know, look at it this way. If you're a cop and you work in a city and there's a lot of crime that you have to deal with, you know, you're going to see some ugly things, and you're going to see the underbelly of humanity that you're dealing with. And to a certain extent, honestly, government oversight is kind of like that. You're seeing the underbelly of government. Maybe you're not seeing the murders and the, you know, the sort of crimes that a cop is seeing, but it's very similar. The problem is you don't want a good cop to say, you know, I'm tired of this. I'm going to kind of move on and do something else. If they do, they certainly are entitled to do that, but what we need to do is continue to raise up other people. You know, the thing we have to remember over and over again is what Reagan was saying about he wasn't a great man, he believed in great ideas. We have great ideas. There's nobody in Washington, D.C. that is irreplaceable. Nobody that's irreplaceable. It's our ideas that are going to conquer. That doesn't mean we don't have great people that are doing great things, but it's the ideas that make them great. It's not the individual themselves. So what I would say is, yes, I'm sad that Jason and Trey Gowdy have stepped down. I know Jason a little bit, and I think he's a great guy. But don't let that discourage you. There are other people that will rise up, you know, especially if we get Congress back, and I think carry out that role very effectively. So don't get discouraged.
Thank you.
Sure. Over here.
How are you doing tonight, sir?
I'm doing great. How are you?
Amazing. Living the dream with all my friends here. My question for you, you brought up a very interesting point on how Senator Bernie Sanders never had a consistent job until a very late age. And I can say I have a better job and before age. But what do you think people on the left, why do they keep going back to those policies? You gave numerous examples on how all these policies have failed. Is it just like a dream that they think is suddenly going to work in the United States? Is it how it's described to them, how it's lied to them? What do you think makes these policies click for people on the left? And do you think we can replicate that on our side with fellow conservatives?
It's a great question. I don't think you can say that it's the same thing for everyone. But my experience is, and I know people, I have friends who love Bernie Sanders. It's not ultimately an intellectual affection. It's an emotional one. It's an emotional one. I mean, look, Bernie Sanders, it's very satisfying for a lot of people to like a guy who's basically the original get off my lawn old man, which is what Bernie Sanders is. I mean, you saw that in the debate the other night where, you know, somebody was calling him out on his health care bill saying, you can't promise that. And Bernie says, yes, I can, because I wrote the bill, you know, and that's sort of the consummate thing. So I think the appeal to the left, for some people, it's intellectual. And with those people, presumably, you can try to have an intellectual conversation. Yeah. For a lot of people, it's emotional. And I think that for some people, especially a lot of the true believers, they embrace Sanders or left socialism. It's almost a form of religion or faith. They believe that there is some sort of a paradise or relative paradise that can be created. They embrace it. It becomes part of them. They become emotional about it. And it becomes almost to the point of, please don't confuse me with facts. I don't want to hear these facts. And I think in those cases, it's very, very hard. I think we have a very strong emotional appeal as well. I mean, the notion of individualism and freedom and the opportunity society is very, very appealing to people. But it's not the utopia that the left pushes. So we're never going to be able to compete on those grounds. I think the best thing we can do is make clear to them that they are worshiping false gods, because that's essentially what they're doing.
Very true. Thank you. God bless you.
Thank you.
With your line of work, Has any of the people you've researched ever put your life in danger other than their mindless supporters?
Well, well, I tell you, we do have security issues that that have come up. I don't really talk about them publicly, but it is an issue. I mean, when you tick off people that are very powerful, that, you know, they get angry, I mean, you have security concerns, but I'm just going to leave it at that.
Thank you.
Thank you. Over here. Yes.
Thank you so much. My name is Cameron Kirk. So I go to Liberty University.
Right.
And unfortunately, I wasn't able to ask any of the senators this, but I'm wondering, based on your expertise on Washington, why, when Republicans had the Senate, the House, and the executive office, did no significant action come to fully defund Planned Parenthood?
To what?
To fully defund Planned Parenthood.
It's a good question. I think it's one of those issues that political figures in Washington, D.C., at least some of them, see the political value in talking about it, but they have the courage to actually do it. It comes down to courage. And there are people that are prepared to do it, but unfortunately, it's not critical mass. And I don't think it's always, you know, some people would say, well, some people that are in swing districts, it's in people that are in very safe districts or very safe states that are just not enthusiastic in pushing it. And I think it's a travesty. And this is where I think accountability of elected officials is important. Look, I'm not saying that every conservative politician should be primaried every time. But look, they get comfortable. They get happy. And they like the social circuit in Washington, D.C. And they don't want to be an outsider. So they start to conform the longer that they stay here. You know, Bobby Jindal, the governor of Louisiana, I did a book with him years ago, and great guy. He served two or three terms in Congress. And he said, you get up there, and everybody starts telling you how smart you are, how attractive you are, how handsome you are, you're going to be president one day, and it starts to go to your head. And he said to me very vividly, he said, when you first get there, you're kind of surprised at everything that goes on, and it's like a cesspool. You stay there long enough, and it starts to resemble a hot tub. And that's kind of the evolution, I think, that happens to a lot of political figures, and I think abortion is one of those issues. And I think voters need to hold them into account on votes that are important to them and let them know that this is an issue that you're prepared to support somebody else against them.
Thank you so much.
Sure.
My name is Corbin White, and I attend Webster University in St. Louis, Missouri. So my question is, all across the United States and all major cities and rural cities, including our nation's capital, homelessness has not been on the forefront of policy change in recent years. What can we do to push the policy change to reduce the amount of homeless and to help those citizens who don't have a voice because the stigma and or financial insecurity they face?
It's a great question, and I think that oftentimes conservatives are mischaracterized as not really offering solutions. I think we do. The solutions, you know, if you look at a lot of the surveys or research that's been done on the homeless population, pretty high percentage of it either suffer from mental illness or substance abuse. So you need to have ways in which those people can be reached. Now, you have the problem of some of those individuals don't want to participate in that kind of arrangement. But I think there are all sorts of things that can be done. I think what the left has done, the reason that you see homelessness so prevalent and so aggressive in places in like San Francisco is they've in effect normalized it. They've in effect said that homelessness is kind of an alternative lifestyle. And we should just sort of, you know, make sure that everybody's okay, but we should sort of tolerate all of this. It's not good for the homeless to be homeless. It's not good for them to be out in a difficult, rough city, sleeping on the streets. And it's not good for communities. So I think it's an opportunity for conservatives to say, look, we want to present these people opportunities. We want to help them. This, I think, is an example of what government can do. Help somebody that's in a truly desperate state. I think most conservatives embrace that. I think that when it comes to people who, you know, simply don't want to work or simply don't want to do anything and they just want to get public welfare, that's where I think conservatives get frustrated.
Thank you so much.
Thank you.
Yeah.
Hi, my name is Rory. I'm from Binghamton University. So I've debated multiple leftists on campus about capitalism versus socialism, but the real-world examples that they use are the Nordic countries like Norway and Sweden, and as multiple speakers have told us throughout the week, that they aren't real examples of socialism. Right. They do have extreme welfare states. So how do we fight back against those examples on campus?
Well, that's a great question. So I had the benefit of growing up with a father who's from Switzerland and a mother who's from Sweden. And I have relatives all over Sweden. And I remember my mother talking about in the 60s and 70s when I was growing up about socialist Sweden, how it was sapping the country. The socialism of Olof Palme and the Swedish Social Democrats in the 1970s no longer exists. Bernie Sanders refers to the Scandinavian social democratic state. It no longer lists. Corporate income taxes in Sweden are lower than they are in the United States, even after Trump's tax cuts. There's a lot of issues related to property, to development, that are easier to do in Sweden than they are in the United States. The one exception is in the area of social welfare, but there are ways in which the Swedish social welfare system actually encourages work more than the American welfare system. So what I would do is I would look, and there's a lot of good literature out there. You probably heard some great speeches from Bert Folsom and others this week talking about this. I would actually research, don't let them stereotype the Scandinavian countries to what they were in the 1970s. They're very different countries. They're not the social democratic welfare states that they were in the 1970s. There's something very different today. They have moved in our direction as we have moved in their direction, which I think is very important.
Thanks so much.
Sure.
Hi. I'm a really big fan of your book, Clinton Cash.
Oh, thank you.
And so my question was about the Clintons. Do you think they're out of the woods in regards to the current Justice Administration, or is there potential for maybe reopen cases or indictments?
Great question. I think that probably any legal consequences of their corruption are probably passed in part because of the statute of limitations. Those laws, depending on which one you're talking about, tend to run 3 to 5 years. So a lot of those occurred longer than that. But what I think is so profoundly interesting to look at where the Clintons are today is look at what's happened to the Clinton Foundation. Based on 2016, when she was running for president. So remember, she's busy. She's running for president. She's not doing anything with the Clinton Foundation. Bill Clinton is helping her. Bill Clinton is fundraising for the campaign. They raised a bunch of money, about $200 million in 2016. 2018, 2 years later, she's no longer running for office. She's not president. Their budget's down 60%. 60%. So the question is, why is that? And the answer is, they were running a pay-to-play influence game. That's the only logical explanation. So, you know, their political legacy, I think, is going to be very tied up with the manner in which they monetized political office. They monetized it. There's no other way to do that. I mean, just think about this for a second. And I raise this with my Democrat friends all the time. They say, you're just picking on the Clintons. And I say, well, wait a second. Imagine if Donald Trump or Vice President Pence or the Secretary of Defense said, or Mike Pompeo, the Secretary of State, said, you know what? I'm going to set up the Pompeo Foundation, and I'm going to take all this money from all these foreign governments, hundreds of millions of dollars, while I'm in office, while I'm charting policy towards these countries. And my spouse is going to hit the lecture circuit and collect, you know, million-dollar speaking fees from all these foreign governments. Nobody would tolerate that for a second. So why do the Clintons get an exception? Well, they get an exception because they just went ahead and did it, and Obama let them do it. So I think their legacy is tarnished, I think, in terms of legal jeopardy. I don't know that there's much left on the corruption side because of the statute of limitations. I do think, and I have no inside knowledge here, of course, I do think that there's just one name that the Clintons need to be worried about, and that name is Jeffrey Epstein. So. Yes.
My name is John Berlaw. I am a graduate of National Journalism Center from many years ago, and I thank Young Americas for keeping it going.
Hey, John.
And so I'm an alumnus, not a student, and normally I would not be taking the time of these brilliant and wonderful students, but there was something in your otherwise brilliant, perceptive speech, just as your books are, Peter, that I profoundly disagreed with.
Okay.
And I'm hoping you can reassess.
Okay.
And that is the end where Admiral Stockdale He is clearly a hero, a great man, but I think he had a woefully bad misperception of what optimism is. It's not false hope, it's not unrealistic expectations, it's even in times of despair, being grateful for all the blessings that God gave you.
Absolutely.
And that's the kind of optimism that Ronald Reagan had. Thanks to National Journalism Center, I had the chance to, you know, have a journalism career and interview many people, including some prisoners of war, including some former prisoners in China. Wei Zhengsheng said, I asked him about optimism, and through a translator, he said, if I hadn't been such an optimist, I would have been dead in this prison within a year. He was talking about how he was, you know, even in solitary confinement, even when he was tortured, he was grateful for his mind and was doing inventions in his mind. So it's easy to be optimistic when you look at what we have compared with what the founding fathers had. And just being optimistic basically means being grateful and looking at what we have and knowing what we can do and what is our responsibility to do.
Well, I would agree with you. I think it all comes down to how you define optimism. And I think what he was essentially defining optimism as is the notion that the end of their struggle was around the corner. And that's not really, I think, a way that you can live your life, because your heart's going to be broken if you do that. His sense of realism, I think, was wrapped up with the notion that I'm going to live the day, I'm going to live the week, I'm going to live the month, and I'm going to brace myself for whatever the future holds. So I think it depends how you define it. But thank you, John.
Like, he himself was an optimist, even if he wasn't.
Yeah, he probably was in that sense, yes. But thank you. I appreciate your comments, John. Yes.
Hi. I'm Joe. I go to Texas State University, and earlier this year, Tim Carney released this book, Alienated America, in which he discusses how the secularization of society has held back the middle class. How can we turn back our society to religion and enhance Americanism, essentially?
I think it's a great question. I think one of the challenges that we face is one of the fruits of this system that we admire and appreciate so much, and that is affluence. I mean, when I encounter people that are truly political and left-wing, they tend to be from either upper middle class or wealthy families. I don't encounter a lot of people that are working class who are embracing socialistic ideas. They have aspirations for the future. They want to have an opportunity. They want to live in an opportunity society. So I think one of the challenges we face is affluence. And I've dealt with people before, they're very professional businessmen that are very successful, and they worry about their kids because their kids are going to inherit wealth, and their concern is they're not going to appreciate or fully grasp or understand what went into the creation of wealth. So I think part of what we have to do is realize that living in an affluent society, we have to remind people, and this, you know, if you're a parent with your kids, you have to remind your people and demonstrate to the people in your life that prosperity does not happen by itself. So that's how I would look at the economic system. When it comes to issues of faith, I think you have the same problem. You know, people tend to look at something larger than themselves. They tend to seek out God, or they tend to seek out a belief system when times are not going well. When the economy is going well and things in their community are going well, it's very easy to sort of step away from those things. So it relies upon us to model it, demonstrate it to other people, not in a way of showing off. You know, somebody I think once said that the best way to speak about your faith is by not actually speaking a word and just showing it, or something like that. I think that's a very powerful way to do it. But it's very hard. In a successful, affluent society that has come to this point because of the belief system that we have and the American system we have, it's very hard to convince people who are seeing all the fruits but none of the toil that went into it to recognize what truly went into it. And that's very hard. You've been a great audience. I'm very optimistic about the future of seeing you guys. Thank you. Thank you. Yes, thank you. Thank you.